God, Allah, manifested himself in this presentation?
He have manifested himself in the person of a man and with the knowledge of the end of the history that we has been in service to white people and the time that we should be separated from them.
Well, what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught was good for the time during the 30s when black people had been castrated, lynched, deprived of freedom, justice, equality, raped. He had to teach that the white man is a devil. His actions towards us is that of a devil.
One of the things that I learned in the Muslim world, I didn't see any racism. I didn't see any conflict between the people over there because of the colors of their skin. Now, these people who had accepted the religion of Islam, who had accepted the existence of one God, automatically the chain reaction effect that this has, they would also have to accept the fact that everybody belongs to one family, one human family. So,
the Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught the highest expression of culture that goes with the consciousness, training that will go with the teaching, and the way of God that goes with the word of God. So our book, Quran, says to us as believers, the original man didn't grow facial hair. All this is a product of intermixing with white people from the caves, and now we got hair everywhere. But the original people, we didn't have hair everywhere like this. We were the builders of civilization, but we start mixing with Captain Caveman in them.
Well, I don't speak for all Muslims, and I actually am a black queer woman in addition to being a Muslim. But I also have this rise of white supremacist and, you know, quote, alt-right, you know, violence that's being committed.
Oh, spare me, that's too dumb.
It's happening.
But don't you also think that primarily you're an American? Aren't we all first and foremost Americans?
I'm black first.
End of conversation. Thanks, Blair.
For example, young Muslims, I'm Muslim. I don't see myself as British in any way or English. But what some people may see themselves as British rather than English if they grew up here because of the St. George's Cross.
But I mean, mostly you grew up here, didn't you?
And the link that has with the Crusades. So young Muslim people aren't going to feel confident putting on that England jersey.
So why do you feel uncomfortable with both, if you like, given that you grew up here?
Me. So I'm African, I'm from Eritrea. Britain tore my country apart, it tore my continent apart, it tore the rest of the world up for quite a long time.
I was invited here today as a Palestinian Muslim American woman, a woman who cares deeply about standing up for the civil rights of all people, the human rights of all people. And between you and me, I'm really tired of having to come to Muslim conferences and have to explain to Muslims why Black Lives Matter is your issue. Brothers here today, is that we didn't need a hashtag that started 2 years ago to tell us as Muslims that Black Lives Matter, because Black life always mattered in Islam.
Since the time of the counterculture and civil rights movements, the left has metastasized into several unholy alliances, like a malignant tumor within the metaphorical body of Western civilization. Most notable, hypocritical, and bizarre among these coalitions is that of Islamic theocrats allying themselves with groups that are not only diametrically opposed to them ideologically, but they are groups that have suffered gravely at the hands of Islamists throughout history, and even to this very day. Leftist atheists, black identity extremists, feminists, LGBTs, and Islamists represent a puzzling and chaotic hodgepodge of completely incompatible ideologies until you realize what they all have in common, and that is they share the same end goal. That is, of course, the subjugation, pacification, hegemonic removal, and eventual displacement of Western whites and their cultures in historically white nations under the guise of diversity, equality, and tolerance. An important weapon implemented by the left to reach this goal is the concept of white guilt. The perpetually aggrieved, power-hungry, and resentful non-white, encouraged and enabled by the self-flagellating and ethno-masochistic Western white leftist, along with other subversive elements, unite to form a coalition of anti-white activists intent on demonizing and shaming the white race into submission, so that we surrender the countries we inherited to those who did not build them, did not maintain them for centuries, and who will irreparably alter them to suit the preferences of their own foreign cultures. One narrative that is so acutely critical to the perpetuation and justification for using guilt tactics against whites is the falsity that European colonial powers created the very institution of slavery and racism, that they enslaved more people than any other race, that our civilization practiced the institution of slavery the longest and with the greatest frequency and brutality, and that our forefathers did everything to perpetuate the peculiar institution and nothing to eliminate it. It is important to note that while this video is most certainly a defense against the anti-white propaganda and guilt tactics of the left, it is not my intention to defend or marginalize the transgressions committed by a small percentage of Westerners in the past concerning slavery. This summation is more so intended to shatter the myopic lens through which many Westerners view the institution of slavery itself, to place the onus for past brutalities upon all of those that are responsible. It is an unquestionable truth that whites receive the vast majority of the world's criticism and demonization for our ancestors' role in slavery, while conversely, non-whites claim little to no responsibility for their ancestors' extensive role in the enslavement of other human beings. In addition, Western whites have not been given the credit they deserve for their instrumental role in largely ending the practice of slavery all around the world. Although the institution of slavery existed well before Islam and Arabia, the largely accepted historical year in which the Muslim slave trade of black Africans began is 650 Common Era. In other words, it was chronologically analogous with the rise of Islam. Although estimates range from 10 to 20 million, 17 million is the largely accepted amount of black Africans that were enslaved by Muslims over the 12 centuries that the trade existed. This means that it is likely that Muslims enslaved more black Africans than white Europeans did, possibly over 5 million more, and their practice of enslaving blacks predates the transatlantic slave trade by over 700 years. The Arabs refer to the 300 to 600 ethnic groups of the Bantu peoples in sub-Saharan Africa as the Zanji, the word itself being recorded in Arabic as Zanjik. This word is used to this very day as an ethnic slur for black Africans. Muslim slaving expeditions into the African interior raided settlements to capture and enslave Bantu peoples, who were then forced to march overland in slave gangs to Muslim-held ports. It is postulated that between the 7th and 20th century, some 4 million black slaves were exported via the Red Sea, another 4 million through the Swahili ports of the Indian Ocean, and perhaps as many as 9 million along the Trans-Saharan caravan routes. Blacks that were enslaved and sold by Muslims were exported all throughout the ancient kingdoms that had coastlines and ports along the Indian Ocean. some reaching as far as the Chinese and Siamese empires of the Far East. Although some Islamic scholars reject the notion of it for obviously biased reasons, the traditional historical narrative suggests that, between the 7th and 10th centuries, black slaves within the Abbasid Caliphate, which encompassed most of the modern Arab world, revolted in a series of massive and brutal slave uprisings. These uprisings became known as the Zanj Rebellions, and were essentially racial wars. Estimates have placed the casualties at 1.5 to 2.5 million dead, and 300,000 died at the Battle of Basra alone. The uprisings are a testament of 1. The sheer quantity of black slaves present in the Abbasid Caliphate, and 2. That the treatment of black slaves was brutal and harsh enough for them to risk death to escape it. Ghanaian scholar, minister, and leader in Islam and Muslim-Christian relations, Dr. John Asuma, wrote in his 2001 book entitled The Legacy of Arab Islam in Africa that he estimates that over 80 million black slaves died during transit to various slave markets in the Islamic world. This was due to the relatively unseaworthy transport vessels, known as dhows, that were used by most slavers, as well as the brutally oppressive African climate along the land routes, to include the Trans-Saharan route. Of course, many also died due to the cruel treatment and utter indifference to human life that many Muslim slavers possessed. Scottish-born explorer and medical missionary Dr. David Livingston wrote of the Arab slave trade in the region near Zanzibar. Quote, "To overdraw its evils is a simple impossibility. We passed a slave woman shot and stabbed through the body and lying on the path. Onlookers said that an Arab who passed earlier that morning had done it in anger at losing the price he had given for her because she was unable to walk anymore. We passed a woman tied by the neck to a tree and killed. We came upon a man dead from starvation. The strangest disease I have seen in this country seems really to be brokenheartedness, and it attacks free men who have been captured and made slaves." Livingston estimated that 80,000 black Africans died along the overland slave routes each year before ever having reached the slave markets of Zanzibar. One particularly brutal aspect of the Muslim slave trade was that it typically dealt in the sale of castrated male slaves. South African-born scholar Ronald Segal, an author of 14 groundbreaking books on international affairs, wrote in his 2002 book entitled Islam's Black Slaves, The Other Black Diaspora, quote, "The Caliph in Baghdad at the beginning of the 10th century had over 7,000 black eunuchs and over 4,000 white eunuchs in his palace. Black boys between the ages of 8 and 12 had their genitalia completely amputated to prevent them from reproducing and mixing with non-black Muslims. According to Segal, about 6 in every 10 boys bled to death during the procedure, according to some sources, but the high price for eunuchs on the market made the practice profitable all the same. One other extremely inconvenient fact for the anti-white propagandists is that various brown and black Muslim groups also enslaved European whites en masse. Robert C. Davis, professor of history at Ohio State University, wrote in his book entitled Christian Slaves, Muslim Masters, White Slavery in the Mediterranean, the Barbary Coast, and Italy, that, quote, "Between the 16th and 19th centuries, around 1 million to 1.25 million Europeans were captured and sold as slaves by Barbary corsairs, who were vassals of the Ottoman Empire. These slaves were captured mainly from seaside villages from Italy, Spain, Portugal, France, England, the Netherlands, Ireland, and even as far as Iceland. They were also taken from ships stopped and boarded by Muslim pirates. Two out of the three European whites that were enslaved by Muslims were women that were turned into sexual slaves by Muslim elitists. However, the Ottoman Empire had been enslaving European Christians since as early as the late 14th century in order to create elite slave armies that served as the household troops of the Ottoman Sultan. Boys aged 8 to 18, mostly from the Balkans and the Slavic regions of southeastern Europe, were taken from their families and were raised to serve and die in the Sultan's armies. This system of kidnapping and enslaving military recruits, known as devzirma, literally meaning lifting or collecting in Ottoman Turkish, was also known as the blood tax or tribute in blood. The tax was only imposed on the Christian subjects of the empire. Imagine for a moment if for over three centuries, European Christians had enslaved members of a certain religious minority and forced them into a life of military servitude as a form of taxation. Would we ever hear the end of it? At the same time Europeans were being abducted and enslaved by Muslim pirates and the Ottoman military, the European powers had come to master the great oceans and discovered the New World. As they arrived and found land and resources to profit upon, their greed and desire for next to free agricultural labor culminated in a period of nearly 400 years in which many white Europeans participated in the Atlantic slave trade, which involved the enslavement of black Africans, Native Americans, and also many white Europeans who were indentured into servitude, normally as payment for their passage to the New World. However, even notable and award-winning left-wing and otherwise cultural Marxist academics, such as David Brian Davis, emeritus professor of history at Yale University and author of an award-winning trilogy of books about slavery, noted in a 1994 article in the New York Review of Books, quote, "Participants in the Atlantic slave system included Arabs, Berbers, scores of African ethnic groups, Jews, Native Americans, and even thousands of New World blacks who had been emancipated or were descended from free slaves." Unquote. In other words, it was not even close to being exclusively conducted by white Europeans. In West Africa, slavers found that the indigenous peoples there partook in the mass enslavement of their rival tribes and ethnic groups. A fully intact, deep-rooted system of slavery was already fully in place and being carried out by Africa's rulers, traders, and military aristocracy well before the transatlantic slave trade began. These black rulers enslaved and sold their brethren to foreigners by the millions in exchange for gold and guns, just so that they could be more successful in killing and seizing power from other black tribes and kingdoms in the region. Foreign traders were discouraged by black African elites from venturing into the interior of the continent, and indeed, it would have been highly unlikely that these traders could have mustered the resources necessary to directly capture the millions of people shipped out of Africa. The Royal African Company, for instance, instructed its agents on the West Coast, quote, "If any differences happen, endeavor in amicable accommodation rather than use force. Endeavor to live in all friendship with them and to hold frequent palavers with the kings and the great men of the country, and keep up a good correspondent with them, ingratiating yourself by such prudent methods." However, in 18th century Europe, Enlightenment thinkers began to dominate the world of ideas, and the concepts of liberty, individuality, and fraternity came to the forefront. Historical events such as the French and American revolutions also strengthened the Enlightenment movement. And as the 18th century ended, many notable English and American leaders, as well as religious groups such as the Quakers, began to question the morality of slavery, and the abolitionist movement was born. During the two decades following the American Revolution, the northern states, beginning with Pennsylvania in 1780, passed legislation abolishing slavery. By 1804, all of the northern states in America had abolished slavery. In May 1787, the Society for Effecting the Abolition of the Slave Trade was formed in London, England. They sought to put an end to the British slave trade and to encourage Britain to endeavor, by way of political, military, and financial might, to force or coerce other countries to ban the slave trade and abolish and outlaw slavery. In the early 19th century, the great powers of Europe began abolishing the international slave trade, setting a precedent for the entire world to follow. After Denmark in 1803, the United Kingdom and the United States outlawed the international slave trade in 1807. However, clandestine trade continued. And so the West Africa Squadron of the British Royal Navy was formed, and warships led efforts to block slave ships entering and departing African transit zones. The blockade of Africa began in 1808, after slave trading was made a felony for British ships. America followed suit and criminalized the slave trade in 1808. By 1845, the West Africa Squadron was one of the largest fleets in the world, containing 36 warships. In 1849, the West Africa Squadron destroyed the Spanish-held slave factory of Lomboco in Sierra Leone. Despite British and American efforts, many African rulers were reluctant to give up their instrumental roles in the slave trade. In the 1840s, King Gezo of the Dahomey in modern-day Benin said that he would do anything the British wanted him to do apart from giving up the slave trade. He famously quoted, "The slave trade is the ruling principle of my people. It is the source of the glory of our wealth, and the mother lulls the child to sleep at night with notes of triumph over an enemy reduced to slavery." Gezo was the king commander and formal husband of Sedong Hongbei, who led an all-female army consisting of 3,000 soldiers against the Egbo fortress of Abeokuta to obtain slaves. King Gezo was married to each of these female soldiers, having sold off all of the menfolk as slaves. For entertainment, Gezo was said to have indulged in the sacrifice of trespassers from neighboring West African countries. The area ruled by the Dahomey, referred to as the Slave Coast, accounted for about 2 million slave exports to the New World, over 15% of the overall transatlantic slave trade. The West Africa Squadron, assisted by the U.S. Navy, succeeded throughout its existence in capturing over 1,600 slave ships, liberating over 150,000 slaves, and serving as a constant deterrent for rogue slavers. As the 19th century wore on, Britain pressed other nations into treaties to give the Royal Navy the right to search their ships for slaves. The Royal Navy also began interdicting slave trading in North Africa, the Middle East, and the Indian Ocean. During the Independence Wars from 1810 to 1826, slavery was abolished in most of Latin America, most by way of treaties with Britain. Slavery continued until 1873 in Puerto Rico, and until 1886 in Cuba. Brazil, the largest importer of black slaves in the world, continued slavery until 1888. In the United States in 1860, the election of Republican and abolitionist Abraham Lincoln caused many southern slaveholding states to fear the economic devastation that would occur as a result of the federal government forcing abolition and emancipation. Eventually, 11 slave states announced their secession from the United States, and the following 4 years were the bloodiest in American history. Intense combat led to the death of over 700,000 white Americans, more than every other American war combined. Thousands of enslaved and freed blacks fought on both sides of the conflict, some freed blacks curiously fighting for the slave states. 365,000 died on the side of the Union, which sought to preserve the Union and end slavery. The Union finally won the war in 1865. The Confederacy collapsed, slavery was abolished, and over 4 million African slaves were emancipated. After all Western powers had predominantly ended the transatlantic slave trade and abolished slavery in their own realms, they set their sights on abolishing it throughout the world. However, African and Middle Eastern countries proved to be the countries most content upon maintaining the institution of slavery, and did very little to stop it unless forced or coerced by Western powers. Although the Ottoman sultans issued various firmans to abolish the slave trade from Africa from 1830 onward, slavery remained legal in the Ottoman Empire, and none of the laws issued had a penalty system behind them until 1871, when a firman was passed that introduced the penalty of a year's imprisonment for those partaking in the slave trade. The Ottoman Empire, along with 16 other nations, signed the Brussels Conference Act of 1890, a collection of anti-slavery measures initiated by the Western powers of the time. The only black or Muslim countries to sign the act were the Ottoman Empire, Persia, Zanzibar, and the Congo Free State, at the behest of the British Empire. From the time of the Brussels Conference until the postmodern age, under pressure from Western powers, the League of Nations, and the UN, slavery was abolished in these Muslim-majority nations. Egypt, 1895. Zanzibar, 1897. Ethiopia, 1902. Morocco, 1922. Afghanistan, 1923. Iraq, 1924. Persia, 1929. North Nigeria, 1936. Qatar, 1952. Pakistan, 1955. Niger, 1960. Saudi Arabia, 1962. North Yemen, 1962. The Truchel States, otherwise known as the United Arab Emirates, 1964, Oman, 1970, Mauritania, 1981, Bangladesh, 1985. Many of these countries formally abolished slavery as a result of their ratification of the 1926 League of Nations Slavery Convention, another Western-led international treaty with the objective of suppressing slavery and the slave trade. Sadly, the illicit practice of slavery and the slave trade is still rampant to this very day in most Middle Eastern and African countries, many of which are black and/or Muslim majority countries or have a significant population of Muslims living in them. Under the administration of the first ever biracial American president, who garnered 85% of American Muslim votes and 93% of black American votes, the Muslim majority country of Libya was destabilized, bombed, and destroyed. The Libyan civil war, which is still raging to this day, has caused a breakdown in secular law and order, and Libyans have regressed to their Islamic tribal roots. As a result, black African migrants that began flowing into Libya in hopes of reaching the welfare states of Europe are currently being captured and sold in open slave markets by Muslim Arabs. This is the Islamic world in 2018, despite the tremendous efforts throughout history by Western nations to eradicate the institution of slavery from the world. Secretary of State of the Obama administration and eventual Democratic presidential nominee, garnered 74% of the Muslim American vote and 88% of the Black American vote. The institution of slavery was practiced by every race, every ethnic group, and every culture on this planet. The practice of slavery was not created by Western whites, and Western whites did not enslave more people than any other race. Only a very small percentage of Western whites were even involved in the financing, trading, and enslavement of other human beings. Retrospectively, Jews were, by proportion, far more likely to be involved in brokering the sale of slaves, investing as shareholders in shipping companies that partook in slaving operations, and owning slaves in antebellum America. Jacob Rader Marcus, a historian and reform rabbi, wrote in his four-volume History of American Jews that in 1860, over 75% of Jewish families in Charleston, South Carolina, Richmond, Virginia, and Savannah, Georgia owned slaves, and nearly 40% of Jewish households across the country did as well. Emile Erlinger & Company, a Jewish banking and investment firm, issued slavery-backed cotton bonds that financed the Confederacy during the American Civil War. In comparison, data from the 1860 U.S. Census shows that only 1.4% of the overall free American population were men who owned slaves. Only 8% of the total number of American households owned slaves. Therefore, 5 years before the Emancipation Proclamation, at the height of slavery, when 3.9 million blacks were enslaved in America, 92% of American families did not own slaves, and 98.6% of American people were not slave owners. Another inconvenient fact for the anti-white propagandists is that many American slaveholders were also black, including Anthony Johnson, a black former slave who in 1655 won the very first judicial determination in the 13 colonies holding that a person who had committed no crime could be held in servitude for life. That person was Johnson's black slave, John Kasser. Johnson's biography paints a historically apt picture of the global prevalence of slavery in all cultures during the colonial era. Johnson himself had been captured and enslaved by his own people in Angola. He was then sold to Muslim slavers, who subsequently sold him to a white tobacco planter in Virginia as an indentured servant. He was one of five people who escaped an Indian attack at the tobacco plantation on which he was working, where the natives enslaved or killed the remaining 52 inhabitants of the plantation. He eventually went on to become a plantation owner himself and was one of several free black slaveholders at the time. The most successful black slaveholder by far was William Ellison, who supported the Confederacy to the extent that he offered up his 53 slaves for labor to the Confederate cause. Ellison even shifted the crop production on his plantation from cotton to mixed crops to supply food for the Confederacy. At the time of his death, Ellison owned 60 slaves. In the era of colonialism, the vast majority of ethnic, cultural, and religious groups in the world practiced slavery. No group can claim complete historical innocence, least of all, perhaps, Muslims or Africans. However, since the 19th century, the West, with its white majority, has been by far the culture that has most adamantly and unsparingly fought to bring an end to slavery, misery, and tyranny around the world. The social Marxist narrative that the U.S. and Britain in particular are most responsible for slavery and racism is patently false. Portugal and Spain, for instance, the countries that played the largest roles in slavery in the New World, are rarely mentioned as racist nations. Brazil, the country that imported 8 times the amount of African slaves that the U.S. did, the most in the world, and has perhaps the most racially stratified social caste in the world, is rarely mentioned as a racist nation. Muslim and African nations, which have prolific and age-defying histories of institutionalized racism and slavery, and to this day still practice race-based slavery, are rarely mentioned as the greatest modern problem. The ancestors of these groups all have great historical responsibility for the institution of slavery, yet did relatively nothing to bring it to an end. Left to their own devices, non-Western cultures are far more likely to practice slavery to this very day. All of these groups aligning is clear evidence that their narrative is contrived and is used as a guilt tactic to shelter their true intention, which is to destroy Western white racial hegemony, culture, and national sovereignty within historically white nations.
Is that we didn't need a hashtag that started 2 years ago to tell us as Muslims that black